excited state. So there are also some different energy levels they are associated. So that is how the you get these particular kind of graphs. And when such groups, they are associated with the chromophores, they will change the energy levels between the ground state and the excited states. And so that is why they are known as the oxochromes. And when you study your sample, let us say that by adding some analyte into your sample, you are changing the lambda max of the absorption after the addition of an analyte in your sample. So that lambda max, it can either go to red side of the electromagnetic spectrum or towards the blue side of the electromagnetic spectrum. So accordingly, that is known as a bathochromic shift or a hypsochromic shift. Or it may be happening that at the same wavelength, the intensity of the radiation of the absorption is changing. So at that time, when intensity is higher, then that is hyperchromic shift. And if the intensity is lower than that time, it is a hypochromic shift. So that is the different kind of phenomena which you will observe in the UV visible spectrum. When the change in the environment will happen, either that change will be there with the addition of the analyte or with the change in the temperature or with the change of the solvent. So all these factors, they are going to affect the spectrum of a given sample when you put such kind of stress to it by changing the concentration also. So all those things will happen. Now, when we talk about the electronic transitions, what are the different electronic transitions which are possible? The different kind of electrons, the very first thing, the kind of electrons which are present in the molecule, they are the sigma bonding, pi bonding, non-bonding, antibonding, and sigma star antibonding. Now, in these particular cases, depending upon the transition, so you can see the energy levels, they are also different energies that are associated with it. So in that case, when the transitions which are happening between the non-bonding electrons to the pi star energy levels, or from the pi to pi star kind of transitions which are happening, so that you can see with the UV visible spectroscopy normal, which is in the range of something around 190 to 900. This is what is the range of the various spectrophotometers which you use in the laboratory. Then when you are having the transitions like N to sigma star, pi to sigma star, because you have to give lot of energy to the system to carry out such kind of transitions like sigma to sigma star, which is very rare to happen. So that you can do when you go to lower wavelength, then that means you are giving more energy, and which generally falls under the region of vacuum UV or far UV. So how you will be doing all these things? You will be doing it with the help of the spectrophotometer, and that spectrophotometer will be possessing a light source. So that source will emit the UV radiations and the visible region radiations. Now that you can do a xenon lamp kind of thing, will be doing both the things at the same time, whereas otherwise generally you see two lamps in the given system. One will emit the UV radiations, another will be doing the visible radiations. Okay, so some other lamps which are there for carrying out this kind of technique is the tungsten halogen lamp or the carbon arc. Now, apart from this, what you need in the system is to create the monochromatism, you need to have wave selectors. So you need to have, I would say, the monochromators which are there. So this wave selectors are nothing else but the filters or the monochromators. And so that will absorb the rest of the light, and the desired wavelength of the radiations will be emitted out. Then sample compartment, where you will place your sample, detector to detect whatever the transmitted light is there. Then a recorder that will give you the output of the whatever the study it has been done. So the spectrometers, the spectrophotometers, they are of two types. One is a single, another one is a double beam. In the case of single beam, you have you can place only one sample cell into the compartment, and generally you need to have two things to be done when you are carrying out the UV visible spectrum. You need to have a blank, and one is the sample, because you are dissolving your sample in some solvent, so that solvent will be treated as a blank. So any effect which will be arising because of the solvent, so that has to be nullified in the given spectrum. So for that, a blank has to be run, and for the given sample, the reading has to be recorded. So when you are having a single beam spectrometer, which has been shown in the slide, so here is a 3D representation of that. You are having a source from where the UV visible radiations, they are being emitted. They pass through this slit, and which will or what we call it as a monochromator, and then it will be through the prism. So it is basically the same representation, and so from here the light will pass into the sample. Now whatever is the transmitted light, that will be detected by the detector. So here is a student model which has been shown for the UV visible spectrometer over here, and as you can see over here, the what has been done, the monochromator has given off only the green light, and the now the color of the light, transmitted light, is different as compared to the absorbed light. So that means now the whatever is the result which is being produced, so that is of different intensity which you are getting. And there are double beam spectrophotometers also, in which you don't have to do firstly the blank, and then you have to take your samples, and then you have to nullify the effect. It is done by the instrument by itself. So what is done over here, this is a light source, and from the light source. So from the light source, the light is being transmitted, and it passes through diffraction grating. So that is where your light is being, it passes through the filters. So now where you get the monochromatic light. Now this monochromatic light, it is being split into two parts. One it will go to the reference cell, that means a blank cell. Another part will go to the sample cell. So whatever the result the detector will get, it will by itself nullify the effect of the solvent, and it will give you the spectrum. So detections you can do with the photocells, phototubes, photomultiplier tubes, photodiodes. So these are the various detector devices which are available. Now coming to the application, so that is the main part. Now how you can utilize this UV visible studies? You can do the analysis like qualitative or quantitative. You can also find the amount of impurities which are present in the given system. You can find out the structure of the molecule. It is also being used in forensic toxicology. So in forensic sciences also, this technique is being utilized a lot. You can determine the molecular weight, fat quality determination, metal contaminants. So various things you can do with the help of this spectroscopy. Now these are some of the examples which I have taken from the literature, some interesting things which I have come across, and and it is related to the topic of your workshop as well. So what is the organic and the pharmaceutical application? So the first example I have taken over here is of glycerol trinitrate. Glycerol trinitrate is also commonly known as nitroglycerin. And if we look at the structure of nitroglycerin, its structure is something like this. Can you tell me if you can compare it with some already known naturally occurring compound? By nitration of that, you can obtain this. Yes, anybody from the audience?
Glycerol, ma'am.
Yes. अगर आप देखो तो ग्लिसरॉल में क्या होते हैं, तीन हाइड्रोक्सिस प्रेजेंट होते हैं. एंड नाउ इफ यू विल कैरी आउट इट्स यू प्रिपेयर द नाइट्रो एस्टर्स ऑफ दैट, यू विल गेट दिस नाइट्रो ग्लिसरीन, राइट? सो दिस इज व्हाट इज योर नाइट्रो ग्लिसरीन, एंड दिस इज अ सिंथेटिक केमिकल, एंड दिस इज वाइडली बींग यूज एज अ मेडिसिन फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ लाइक whenever there is a heart failure or high blood pressure or there is a angina pain, that means a chest pain. So in those cases, nitroglycerin is being used as a medicine to treat such kind of things. And if you look into this, this molecule is possessing mainly the sigma bonds or the pi bonds. And in order to study the transitions, we need to have a good chromophore, ठीक है? So which we can study in the visible spectrum and we can see some color change. So in this particular case, in order to carry out the analysis, like this nitroglycerin tablets, they are there in the market, and in order to validate that what is the amount of nitroglycerin present in that given sample or tablet. Tablet ke upar likha hota hai na ki ye particular jo drug molecule hai isme, it is present as 5 milligram, it is present as 10 milligram or 50 or 500 milligram. So in order to validate, like from the, when you get, you are getting it from good companies, so whatever is there later written on the that medicine, so generally you will see that almost same composition is there. Maybe that with time, when you see that the expiry has happened, so then that means some degradation of the drug has happened with time. And in order now to find out that how much of the sample has got degraded with time, and now what is the exact concentration of the drug in the given sample, so you can find out with the help of this UV spectroscopy. Now how you will do that? What is being done in this particular case is that now, as I said, that this nitroglycerin is nothing else but the nitroesters. So now when you will hydrolyze this nitroglycerin, so that will release nitric acid. Now nitric acid, quantitatively you can measure that how much of nitric acid has been released. And from there you can judge out that how much amount of nitroglycerin is present. Ab wo jo nitric acid release ho raha hai, you treat it with this phenol 2,4-disulfonic acid. So when this nitric acid, which is released from the nitroglycerin, it reacts with your this sulfonic acid derivative, the nitration of it will happen. Now this is a yellow colored compound, and its potassium salt, it absorbs at 450 nanometer. So now you know that in a particular graph, this at 450 nanometer, you are having this particular absorption happening. Now I have taken the tablet from the store, and I do not know that now what is the concentration. So what I will do, I will prepare a set of solutions. So I will prepare some 1 millimolar solution, 10 millimolar solution of the same salt, okay? Now, or then 20 millimolar, 50 millimolar. I can record the UV visible profile of this. Now, what you see over here, your Beer-Lambert law is going to apply over here. So when you are having lower concentration, the absorption is going to be less. When you are having higher concentration, the absorption at the same wavelength, it is going to be more. So now I can prepare a graph that if this is a concentration and this is the amount of absorption, I know that this is going to be a linear profile. Hamara jo Baer-Lambert law hai, it is applicable linearly. So you will say that, okay, when the lower concentration is there, this was the amount of absorption. 1 millimolar kitni hai, 10 millimolar kitni hai, 20 kitni hai, 50 millimolar kitni hai. Now I will take a sample from outside, unknown sample. Known sample, but of unknown concentration. I will record its absorption. I know now the value of absorption. Let us say that it will come over here. I will plot it. From here, now I can find out that what is the concentration of the nitroglycerin from here. So indirect method I can apply and I can find the concentration. So this is how the spectroscopy has been helpful to me, that I can find the concentration. उसके जो बाहर पैम्फलेट है उसके ऊपर लिखा हुआ है 500 मिलीग्राम पर टैबलेट, बट व्हेन आई विल फाइंड आउट सॉरी समथिंग लाइक 50 मिलीग्राम इन द पैम्फलेट, बट व्हेन आई हैव रिकॉर्डेड द आई हैव कैरीड आउट द हाइड्रोलिसिस एंड देन आई हैव ट्रीटेड इट विद द फिनॉल 2,4 डाइसल्फोनिक एसिड एंड देन रिकॉर्डेड इट्स यूवी विजिबल स्पेक्ट्रम, I found that the concentration is not 50 milligram, but it is less than that. So this is how I can find out how much amount of degradation has happened with time in the given sample, in the commercial samples as well. Okay. I hope it is clear to everyone. Now let me go to the next example where I can determine the phenolic compounds. Some phenolic compounds, they are helpful to us, like we have been using it, like anthocyanins, they are the phenolic compounds which are found in grapes, and after their fermentation you find them in wines as well. They basically they accumulate in the these berries or grapes, and then their concentration it can be found with the help of this UV visible spectroscopy. So what will happen is that when you are having a phenolic compound, so I am just giving you an example. So this is an example, just a general structure of a phenol with some okay, let me with some substituent present. Now when I will treat it with the ferric ions. Ferric ions, what is the formula, what is the oxidation state of iron in this ferric ions? Yes, anybody from the audience can tell me? Ferric ions or ferrous ions hote hai na? So ferric ions mein oxidation state kitni hoti hai iron ki?
Mab 3 positive aur ferrous mein 2 positive.
Okay, so when you are having these the ferric ions which you can have from ferric sulfate or ferric chloride, so when your phenolic compounds they are treated with this ions, you will get the corresponding salt. Okay, and this salt is generally violet in color. So again, from the intensity of the amount of this salt which is being formed, jitni salt ki concentration zyada hogi, violet color ki intensity utni zyada hogi. So from there you can find out that what is the amount of anthocyanin present in the given sample. And then you can also it is helpful in distinguishing between the conjugated and the non-conjugated dyes. So when you are having a dyeing system, but which is a non-conjugated one, something like this, the other one in which you are having is the same number of carbon atoms I have shown, but the other one it is a conjugated one. So now the UV spectrum of this and the UV spectrum of this is going to be different, because now in this case the double bond which is showing the pi pi star transitions, so they are isolated from each other, so their UV profile is going to be different, whereas in this case the two double bonds, they are conjugated with each other. So the pi-pi transitions, so the energy gap for the pi-pi transitions, it has been reduced. So ye jo first case hai, ye jo second case hai, this is how they look like. Now for the first case, you have to provide more energy. In the second case, you have to provide lesser energy. So lesser energy means longer wavelength. So that is how they will absorb at two different wavelengths. And so you can distinguish that if the two double bonds, they are present, whether they are in the conjugated state or they are in the non-conjugated states. Then you can also find the impurities. Then this is another example where this propanthiolene bromide, this is nothing else but a anticholinergic drug. You can see its uses in the US pharmacopoeia. US pharmacopoeia may like you can put the name of this drug in the Google and then you add the term US pharmacopoeia and you will come to know that what is this molecule it is being used to. The structure of this molecule is something like this. So this is propanthiolene bromide and this is an anticholinergic drug and it is being used to treat problems related to gastric disorders, Parkinson's disease or some problems related to the bladder also. So this is what it is being used. Now this compound it is hydrolyzable. Hydrolyzable ka matlab kya hua? It can be easily hydrolyzed. You can see there is an ester functionality. So this is from where this can be easily hydrolyzed to give you its byproduct. And its byproduct is xanthanoic acid. Okay? So this is xanthanoic acid and this is propanthiolene bromide and so this hydrolyzes to give you this xanthanoic acid slowly. So this is how the drug will degrade with time and you can find out its levels again with the help of UV visible spectroscopy that how much of the concentration of the drug is there in the given tablet. So this is the way you can find out the various I would say the impurities present in the given sample. Then you can also find out in the structural elucidation, like in if you see the structure of vitamin A and vitamin A2, you will see the only change is over here. There is one additional double bond. So then that means it will absorb at a different wavelength from this. So that is what is there. Vitamin A1 will absorb at 325 nanometer and A2 will absorb at 351 nanometer because it has got one additional double bond which is conjugated to the system. So that is how you can identify ki maine agar aapko, let us say in a laboratory I have given you two samples, I have told you one of them is vitamin A, another one is vitamin A2, one is vitamin A1. Now how you can find out the difference between these two? By looking at the molecules or given samples, you will not be able to tell me that which is A1, which is A2. Of course, by doing its UV visible spectroscopy, you can easily find out the differences. Now, let me discuss. So this was the fundamentals of UV visible spectroscopy. Now let me discuss the applications where we have utilized this spectroscopy in our research problems and how we have, because basically I'm working with various diagnostics. And so that is how I will show they have been helpful to me. So this is a first example where I have synthesized this particular, my group have synthesized this particular molecule. This is a naphthalamide based molecule. If the structure is not clear to you, you can go and have a look at this paper, this journal article from where you can get more information. So this is an organic molecule which we synthesized. Now, Can you tell me that what you can tell me about the solubility of the organic compounds in the water?
Non-soluble.
Non-soluble hai. But I have the medium which is being given to me. When I'm working with the real samples, let us say from the environment, some water sample I have obtained, or from the biological medium, we know that 70% of water is present in our body. So in all these samples which I'm procuring, either from the environment or from the biological studies, for the biological studies, they are in the aqueous medium. Now, when I have prepared this particular receptor, which is a completely organic molecule, and I want this to act as a receptor for an analyte. We all know the lock and key mechanism of the enzymes. So what happens is that the enzyme, it acts as a lock, and your analyte or whatever the molecule which has to undergo catalysis, so that is acting as a key in that. So similarly, when I want to detect the presence of certain analyte, the organic molecule which I have synthesized, so this will act as a lock for me, and to which the, so this is how it will be happening. So this is a lock which I have prepared, a receptor, and the analyte, it will go and interact with this, and some change I will see in the UV spectrum of this receptor. So from there I can say that, okay, so this analyte is present, and what is the concentration of this analyte which is present in the given sample. So this is what I have been using, this technique. So now I was talking about it, the solubility of it in water. So what happens is that in the organic receptor which I have synthesized, I have to use this molecule as a receptor in the aqueous medium. So what I have done is that I have prepared there, I think you know what are the colloidal solutions. Colloids mein kya hota hai? Again, some non-soluble things, they are made to suspend in the aqueous medium. If your medium is aqueous in nature, hydrophilic in nature. So similar thing we have done. So by a technique, what we have done is that we have made our organic compound to suspend. Instead of getting separated out from the water, we have suspended it in the form of very small particles, which are of the size of in a nanometer scale. So we have suspended them in water. So now we can utilize them as a probe. So then what we have done, we have on the surface of these small particles of the receptor, we have coated these on the gold nanoparticles. Now we have found that it can sense okadoic acid. Okadoic acid is nothing else but a toxin which is being produced by the shellfish or the marine sponges. So the people who go into oceans or water, so when they, because these marine animals, they are being taken as a food also. And generally you see in the countries like Japan or China or Korea, so in those areas, and in the on the shore areas, so there you people see that many times the people, they depend upon the marine food, and shellfishes or the marine sponges, they are one of them. And so this okadoic acid is present in these shellfishes, and it is nothing else a polyketide. So this is known to be a toxic material. So when somebody consumes shellfish which is having okadoic acid in large quantities, so that will result in gastric problems. So in 1960s and 70s, such kind of problems the people they saw in Netherlands, Japan. So they came to know that this problem is arising because of the presence of okadoic acid in these marine animals which they are consuming. So if in the given sample, which is let us say some shellfish, it has been provided to you in your food. So if you want to know that whether it has got spoiled and how much level of the ochotic acid is present in that, so that you do not get affected by it. So this is the thing which we have studied over here. We can find out the concentration of ochotic acid by preparing such kind of system. So isme kya ho raha hai, this gold nanoparticles which are coated with this receptor, when they interact with the ochotic, so this is what is jo ye blue colored ka isme hai, so this is ochotic acid. This ochotic acid is interacting with your this receptor, the whole receptor system, and accordingly the UV profile which has been shown over here, so that is being observed. So isme na bahut aapko ye colorful si lines nazar aa rahi hongi, so and these arrows they which are being shown. So what does this mean, that what is the effect on the absorbance? This is the absorbance points, and with the changing concentration of ochotic acid. So when the ochotic acid is being added into this receptor, slowly pehle aapne 1 millimolar dala, fir 2 millimolar, fir 3 millimolar. So as and when this ochotic acid is coming into contact with this probe, the concentration of it is the absorbance, amount of absorbance is also increasing. So jo ye is tarah ka ek complete receptor plus analyte ka jo ek conjugate ban raha hai, so its amount is also increasing with time by addition of the ochotic acid, and so the absorbance, amount of absorbance is also changing. So now from here you can find out what is the concentration of ochotic acid in a given sample. So this is one thing which we have prepared, and this is what we have recently published. And then another example which I will discuss about, aap logon ne apni laboratories mein pH paper use kiya hua hai? Yes, anybody from audience?
Yes ma'am.
What do you understand the role of pH paper when you treat it with the, or when you dip it in acid, or when you dip it in a base? अच्छा, let me tell you, आपके पास दो different kind of bases हैं. One is sodium bicarbonate, another one is sodium hydroxide. So उसमें आपने दोनों में pH paper dip किया, so what you will get? Yes, anybody from the audience? दोनों bases हैं, एक sodium bicarbonate है, एक sodium hydroxide है. So pH paper dip करोगे तो आपका result क्या आएगा? Has anybody used any time?
Sodium hydroxide में dark हो जाएगा pH paper, dark blue.
Dark blue हो जाएगा. And what about in sodium bicarbonate? That is going to be relatively, it will be of lesser intensity. It is more of a greenish type. राइट,
यस मैम,
ब्लू ग्रीन टाइप. और जो आपका सोडियम हाइड्रोक्साइड है उसमें डार्क ब्लू हो जाता है. सो देन दैट मींस द कंसंट्रेशन ऑफ द बेस इज अफेक्टिंग, और द दैट इज अफेक्टिंग द कलर ऑफ द पीएच पेपर. सो फ्रॉम हियर व्हेन टू सॉल्यूशंस आई हैड गिवन यू टू बीकर्स, एक में सोडियम बाइकार्बोनेट डाला था, एक में मैंने डाला था सोडियम हाइड्रोक्साइड, बट आई डिडंट टेल यू that which is which one. So I told you to check it with the help of pH paper and tell me. So you could tell me right away by dipping in the pH paper ki this one is sodium bicarbonate and the other one is sodium hydroxide, right? So similarly, if now what we have done, we have prepared a portable diagnostic tool, something like by using a smartphone you can find out that even in the given sample, if a probe which we have prepared, that probe we have prepared its complex with copper ions. Theek hai, ek aap logon ne complexes padhe hue hain, organometallic complexes or your coordination complexes, you people have come across these terms hopefully. When you have an organic compound and you complex it with copper, you prepare a coordination complex. When that organic compound is ligating with your metal salt, through the various heteroatoms. So now when you are having such kind of probe, and from the given sample, there are cysteamine, which is a biomolecule which is there. And if you want to estimate its levels in the aqueous or the biological system, so depending upon the concentration of the cysteamine, तो ये जो color change आ रहा है, ये जो complex जो ये आपका receptor है, and this is the when it has got interacted cysteamine, so different color is there. So now the similar thing we have done over here by changing the concentration, the color of the intensity. The intensity of the color that is going to change in all these cases. So now when you are having a different solutions, sample solutions, jisme cysteamine alag alag concentrations mein hai, ek mein 5 micromolar hai, ek mein 10 micromolar hai, ek mein 20 micromolar hai, un sab ka color different hai, theek hai, but exactly kis mein kitna hai, 5 kis mein hai, 10 kis mein hai, 20, 25, 22, 26, किसमें कितनी कितनी कॉन्सेंट्रेशन है, आप मोबाइल में उसकी से उसकी पिक्चर क्लिक करो, मोबाइल में एक ऐप होगा, आपकी वो पिक्चर उसमें फीड हो जाएगी, वो जैसे ही उसमें फीड हो जाएगी आपको पता लग जाएगा कि जो ये जो गिवन सैंपल है इसमें सिस्टमिन जो है 5 मिलीमोलर था, जो दूसरा सैंपल आपने जिसकी फोटो क्लिक की उसमें सिस्टमिन 15 मिलीमोलर है, कोई और सैंपल है उसमें सिस्टमिन की कॉन्सेंट्रेशन जो है, so that is maybe something like 16 millimolar. So this is how this app which we have developed, a portable diagnostic tool which we have developed, it is being useful. So this is being utilized as a smartphone app, and wherever you can go you can find out the concentrations. Okay, so this is what is very much helpful. Then similarly, this is another thing which we have done. You can find out the levels of mercury. So whenever the mercury it interacts with the probe which we have synthesized, the azaphenol based, then some color change is going to be there. So from that color change, you split it into red component, blue component, because this is what it is there. ठीक है ना? अगर आपका जो basic colors होते हैं, वो कौन-कौन से होते हैं? Red, blue, and green. ठीक है, और बाकी के जो कलर्स है इनकी मिक्सिंग से ही बनते हैं. सो दीज थ्री डिफरेंट कलर्स यू आर व्हाट एवर द सिग्नल यू आर गेटिंग यू स्प्लिट देम इनटू डिफरेंट कलर स्कीम्स एंड देन यू कैन क्वांटिफाई ईच कलर एंड अकॉर्डिंगली यू कैन क्वांटिफाई द लेवल्स ऑफ मर्करी. सो दिस इज अनदर एग्जाम्पल विच वी हैव डन ओवर हियर. नाउ दिस वॉज वट आई हैड ट्राई टू गिव यू टू मेक यू अंडरस्टैंड अबाउट द यू विजिबल स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी. देन आई हैव डिस्कस्ड about the technique, and then finally how you can apply it in your research laboratory as well. So this as a diagnostics where you can apply this tool. So this was what related to UVisible. Now the next part which is there is the IR spectroscopy. So I have stopped sharing my this slide, and now I will go to the next thing, which is IR spectroscopy. Now let me share that thing with you. If you do you people want to have a break or we shall continue?
Hello ma'am, I think we should have a break. Even you must be tired from the hour long lecture.
No, it's fine. I can talk for another 1 hour, no problem.
I was thinking that we should take questions if students have any related to UV visible spectroscopy, and then we will move to IR spectroscopy.
That is good. So
yes students, anyone wants to ask anything to ma'am related to UV visible spectroscopy?
No ma'am, but very informative lecture ma'am, thank you ma'am.
Okay,
welcome. So whenever there are no questions the two things happen, right? I have understood everything.
Yes ma'am, kyunki to है ये ना,
बढ़िया है, कोई क्वेश्चन ही नहीं है. ओके, एनीवन एल्स? maybe having any query, any question related to UV visible. All of you do read it in your syllabi. I know you are intelligent students, but you may have some query. Okay, no. So I think we should move to IR. Anji ma'am, I think we should start with IR.
Yeah, but I was expecting questions in the case when I had talked about some real applications. But anyhow, let us now continue with the IR spectroscopy now. So let me share the slides. So I hope it is visible to all.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay, so revising the things, what we have done in the UV visible, as I said that in the electromagnetic spectrum, you are moving from longer wavelength to shorter wavelength, or you are moving from the higher energy to the lower energy of the system. So now I have given another way of things, that when you are doing the spectroscopy, which is dealing with the X-rays, then you are talking about the ionization. So this is the first thing which will happen. When you are doing the UV visible spectroscopy, then you are talking about the electronic transitions, as I have shown. Then when you are using the IR spectroscopy, you are talking about the vibrations which will happen in the molecule. So whenever you will give some energy to the system, then the molecules, they also tend to vibrate at the same place, or they can rotate when you give a lower energy like microwave. And if you are supplying energy from the radio radio waves, when you are using, then you talk about the nuclear spin rotations, and then that is where your NMR spectroscopy will come. Here is your microwave spectroscopy will come, and this is your IR. So my now next talk is related to this portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. So now this molecular spectrum which you are having, this is as I shown previously also. So this A and B states which have been shown over here, they are the electronic energy levels. So now this is a more clearer image you are getting, that each energy level, electronic energy level, so this and this, they are the associated vibrational energy levels. Similarly, these and these, they are the associated energy levels, vibrational energy levels for the given higher excited state system. And with this, each vibrational energy, this is what is the associated rotational energy levels. So each and every vibrational energy levels is further split into the rotational energy levels. So this is how it has been shown over here. So this is a three splitting which is being observed, that is the electronic or the vibronic and the vibrational and the rotational spectrums. Now when we talk about the IR spectroscopy, so it is infrared radiations which are interacting with the matter, and the absorption of the IR radiations will happen. And mainly it is used for the analysis of organic materials and some polyatomic inorganic molecules and the organometallic complexes also. So depending upon what is the energy of the IR radiations you are using, so that will be split into far infrared, mid infrared, near infrared, and limit of the red light. When you are talking about the biological systems, then you have to use a different IR spectroscopic range. Or when you are talking about the organic molecules in the chemistry lab, then you are using like mid infrared. In the biological system, you go for the far infrared. So this kind of thing is there. And that is the different radiations, energy of the radiations of the IR spectrum is being used to study the different samples. Now, when you talk about the vibrations present in the system, so this is being talked about in the Hooke's law, and it says that, let us say, the two atoms which are present, they can be joined with the spring. So when you will provide the energy, either you stretch it or you compress. So accordingly, they will start vibrating, and that will affect the bond length of the system. So जब आपका stretch होगा तब आपकी bond length differ होगी, जब आपका compress हुआ तो bond length different होगी. So that will be the basis for your IR spectroscopy. So that is being done with the harmonic oscillator model, and this is a formula which is generally being used where the wave number is indirectly proportional to your the reduced mass, and it is directly proportional to your force constant. Force constant you get from the binding energy of the two atoms which are bound with a bond, and the reduced mass is the masses of these two bound atoms. So this reduced mass is further calculated from this formula, and this is how it is helpful to us. So when the double bond is there, or a triple bond is there, or a single bond is there, the force constant in all these cases is different. If let us say that in all the cases the two atoms which are bound with each other, that is the carbon atoms, so us case mein reduced mass so aapka change nahi hua, only change is there with the with respect to your force constant, and that will be giving you the different the signals at the different places in the IR spectrum. So now this is what has been shown over here. So single bonds is going to be appearing at 1200 centimeter inverse in the spectrum. Double bond is going to be, because the force constant is increased, so accordingly the position of these functional groups in the given spectrum is also going to change. Or like this is a case when the reduced mass is changing. So now you are having the case where in all the cases a single bond is there. So this is on the basis of the assumption, let us say, that the force constant is same, though it should not be same, kyunki aapka jo ye atom hai wo change ho raha hai every time, and the electronegativity difference is also changed, so the force constant is obviously not going to change. But it has been taken as an assumption, let us say, that it is not much variable. So the only change is mainly on the basis of the masses associated with these. So that is how the different these functional groups, they will appear at the different positions. So now when in this case the reduced mass is going to be very less, and in this case kyunki iodo group ka mass kafi zyada hota hai as compared to hydrogen, so that is why the reduced mass is going to increase, the value of mu is going to increase, and that will affect the position in its spectrum. So the important thing over here is that when we are talking about the vibrational frequencies which are associated with it, when the vibration energy levels, they are involved from the ground state to the excited state, the transitions, they are possible only when the transitions are infrared active. So then that means which transitions are infrared active, where there is a change in the dipole moment. Right, so like over here, when you are having a carbon dioxide, this is a very good example which is generally being discussed. So in this particular case, whenever the vibrations are happening, because this molecule is possessing otherwise a dipole moment, but when it is stretching at the same time in opposite directions, or when it is compressing at the same time to same quantity in the to the center point, so in both the cases that overall dipole moment is not changing, so then its stretching is not IR active. ठीक है. सो दिस इज व्हाट इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग टू बी केप्ट इन माइंड. द आईआर एक्टिव ट्रांजिशंस आर ओनली दोज इन विच देयर इज अ चेंज इन द डाइपोल मोमेंट. सो दिस इज द सिलेक्शन रूल, वन ऑफ द सिलेक्शन रूल विच इज देयर. एंड सो दैट विल अगेन द dipole moment which is there that will arise because of the change in the electronegativity difference. And so that is why these are some of the electronegativities which are associated. And so there will be the dipole moment associated with the system. And if those changes they are there, then the transitions can be observed. So here is an example of the carbon dioxide which has been again shown over here. That symmetrical stretching in both the directions, and here is an example of the asymmetrical stretching which should be observed in the case of which is it should be a strong peak which should be observed around over here, because now there is a change in the dipole moment. And similarly with the help of the scissoring bending and the scissoring over here. So this is an example where the scissoring can happen in the same plane, and the stretching is happening in the same plane and the bending is happening in the two different planes. So you can see the strength of the signal. Jo ye asymmetrical hai, isme dipole moment zyada change ho raha hai, observed ho raha hai. So this is how the intensity of the signal is there. In the case of the bending or in the case of symmetrical stretching, symmetrical stretching, which should be around at 1340 centimeter inverse by calculation, you do not see in this region. ठीक है ना, इस region में ये observe ही नहीं हो रहा है क्योंकि इसमें dipole moment change नहीं हो रही है. So here are examples of some of the IR active bonds. इस case में देखो ये एक symmetrical molecule है, हालांकि so this is not going to be RIR active. However, there in this kind of systems you will see the IR active signals for the nitriles or for this alkynes when they are terminal ones, or in these cases. So in some kya hai, dipole moment hai, so you will be able to see the change in the dipole moment and you can see the signals in the IR spectrum. So I have already talked about these signals which are there in the stretching and the bending. I have already talked about जो ये vibrations होती हैं, दो तरीके से होती हैं. One of them is stretching, another one is bending. So bending is happening in the stretching is moving out or in. So this is how this thing is happening. But whereas when you're talking bending, you are talking about it in a different plane. And so whereas in the case of stretching or in the case of stretching, no bond angle is changing. Only the length of the bond is changing. So in the case of bending, the bond angle is changing, but the bond length is not changing. So this is what is the difference between these two. So here are some of the stretching vibrations. Symmetric इसलिए होगा कि equal amount में दोनों stretch करेंगे या compress करेंगे. Asymmetric इस तरह से होगा कि एक stretch करेगा और एक compress करेगा. So this is the difference between the symmetric and asymmetric. And then bending is in plane or out of plane. So when you are, I will just show you the structure. So this is what is bending when it is happening. So this thing which has been shown over here to show a plane, this may ye dono carbon hydrogens, ye all these three are present in the same plane. Now when the bending is happening in such a manner that they are staying in the same plane, but they are coming close. The bond angle is changing. So this is known as scissoring. Wagging tab hoga, isme bond angle hi change hoga, but they are going out of the plane. Carbon isi plane mein reh raha hai, but dono hydrogens plane se bahar ja rahe hai. So then that is wagging. Rocking tab hogi, jab ye tino fir plane mein hi rahenge, but then all of them they are moving in the same direction. So that is rocking. And twisting tab hoga, jab ek plane ke पीछे चला गया, एक प्लेन के सामने चला गया और कार्बन इज स्टेइंग इन द सेम प्लेन. सो दैट इज ट्विस्टिंग. So these are the bending vibrations and these are the stretching vibrations. And for these functional groups, which have been written over here, the values for the symmetric and the asymmetric stretch is also been given. So this as a reference you use when you get an IR spectrum of a given sample. Then what is the instrumentation which you use? So what you do is that you are having the source of light, IR source of light. It is made incident upon the sample, and whatever the light is being transmitted, that is detected by that detector. And now what information you get from this information, from the absorption of different functional groups, you see that this is a whole spectrum of IR spectrum of the chemical compounds ranging from 600 to 4000 centimeter inverse. So whenever you see signals which are coming in between the range of something like 2700 to 3500, you will see that it will be coming because of some NH, OH or CH groups. Or agar koi signal hamare paas aata hai somewhere between 2200 to 2300 or 2400, so then that means it is because of the triple bonds, which is C triple bond C or C triple bond N. And when you are having a signal which lies in between 1600 to something like 1900, we mainly claim it because of C double bond C, C double bond O and C double bond N. And generally the other part, the rest of it, is known as a fingerprint region. So whenever you are having a signal in this particular range, and you also see the signals in the fingerprint region, then you can easily work out on the structure of the given molecule. So this is again a same, this is an example basically of butanol, which will tell you about the functional groups. So in this case, mein kya hai? Ya to C single bond C hai, ya C single bond hydrogen hai, ya C single bond oxygen hai. So these three kind of functional groups, they are there. So that is being observed in this particular region, OH jo signal yahan par observe ho raha hai. Whereas in the fingerprint region, you see CO. इसमें आपको ओ एच का सिग्नल नजर आ रहा है, इसमें आपको सी ओ का सिग्नल नजर आ रहा है. सो दैट विल कोलैबोरेट टुगेदर टू गिव यू, एंड यू आल्सो सी 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 एंड सी एच सिग्नल्स. सो दैट विल टेल यू द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द फंक्शनल ग्रुप्स प्रेजेंट इन द गिवन मॉलिक्यूल. हियर इज अनदर रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द सेम ग्राफ. सो दिस इज हाउ इन द वेरियस वेज द सेम थिंग इट कैन बी रिप्रेजेंटेड. And now this is the actual values table has been shown over here. As I said, that certain frequencies which are IR active, so that is going to give you strong signals, and the other frequencies, they can be medium to weak, and or they cannot be observed depending upon how much energy is being absorbed by the system. So each and every group which has been shown over here, so they are giving you a signal at a different wave numbers. Okay, so first thing you can observe is the hydrogen bond. Ab kya hai ki whenever let us say that your this carbonyl compound is there. Now this is an important group to be discussed, because in the biological medium, whenever you talk about the proteins and the peptides, the amide linkage is there, right? Now this thing is very much important to understand that let us say in the given peptide or protein, either this linear chain of amino acids, either they are open linear chain, something like this, or they can be some two-dimensional or three-dimensional entangled structures. Is tarah se kuch banayenge. So whenever you are having an entangled structure like this, now the bond length of the carbonyl will be affected, because it is going to form some hydrogen bonds which is present over there in the same protein chain. Ek protein chain hai jisme usne the molecule, this linear chain is going like this, then it has taken a turn, then it has taken a turn like this. Now when it is taking some turns, so at those turns these kind of bondings may be present. At these places, the bonding is going to be weak. At the point of crossing, the force constant is going to be different, क्योंकि interaction strong होगी, क्योंकि ये carbonyl oxygen और ये hydrogen, they are quite close to each other. So that is how you can determine the 2D or 3D structures of the protein molecules. Let us say when you are having a native protein which has been isolated from a biological medium, उसका एक particular IR spectrum होगा. Now when after some time आपने उस protein को heat किया, so what will happen? It will start denaturing. So denature होगा तो उसमें वो जो various bonds which are present apart from the covalent. Covalent bonds के ऊपर इतना effect नहीं होगा. Effect होगा जब ये आपके non-covalent linkages हैं, like hydrogen bond is there. So that might break up. So that is why the protein has got opened up, its structure has got opened up. So in that case, now its IR spectrum is going to be different. अगर आपका ये जो opened up structure होगा, sorry, when you are having this opened up structure, उसमें जो carbonyls हैं, उनका हाइड्रोजन बॉन्डिंग उतना स्ट्रॉन्ग नहीं होगा विद द सम नियर बाय एनएच एटम्स. सो नाउ दिस इज, लेट अस से दिस इज अ सेकेंडरी और टर्शियरी स्ट्रक्चर, दिस इज कमिंग फ्रॉम अ प्राइमरी स्ट्रक्चर. सो नाउ द आईआर स्पेक्ट्रम इज डिफरेंट बिकॉज इसमें जो फोर्स कांस्टेंट ऑफ कार्बोनिल इज डिफरेंट, एंड ओवर हियर द फोर्स कांस्टेंट ऑफ द कार्बोनिल इज गोइंग टू बी डिफरेंट. इसमें वीकर हो जाएगा फोर्स कांस्टेंट, क्योंकि इसमें ऑक्सीजन हाइड्रोजन बॉन्डिंग भी कर रहा है, नाइट्रोजन दिस हाइड्रोजन ऑफ द अमाइड ऑफ सम अदर चेन. सो दैट इज हाउ यू कैन डिटरमिन वेदर द गिवन प्रोटीन हैज गॉट सम चेंजेस इन इट्स स्ट्रक्चर्स विद टेम्परेचर और विद सम अदर एनवायरमेंटल चेंजेस. सो दिस इज हाउ इट इज वेरी मच हेल्पफुल, दिस टेक्निक इज हेल्पफुल. So this is the same thing I have talked about, the effect of hydrogen bonding. Now coming to the instrumentation, already we have passed the given time. So let me, these are some of the instruments which are there. Some latest instruments, the pictures of which they have been shown, like Perkin-Elmer or from the Brook tensor, they are there. So the instruments, they are divided into two parts. One is dispersive or FTIR, and in the dispersive, this is again a double beam one. So what is there is a light source is there. So over here you are having one reference or a blank sample, or this is a sample cell, and the radiations, they pass through the photometer and then monochromator and then finally through the detector. So this is how a simplified version of dispersive IR spectrometer is there. And some of the IR sources which are being used in this are like the Nernst Glower, Globar, tungsten filament, and mercury lamp, carbon dioxide laser. So these are some of the IR sources. So depending upon it, you, आपकी क्या requirement है, आप कौन से region को study करना चाहते हैं, so accordingly you can decide upon that which source you should use. Similarly, the detector, when you are having a thermocouple, so they are very cheap one, but they are relatively less sensitive. बोलोमीटर काइंड ऑफ डिटेक्टर होगा तो हाईली सेंसिटिव होगा. पायरोइलेक्ट्रिक है, दे आर वेरी फास्ट एंड दे आर वेरी सेंसिटिव ऑल्सो, एंड दैट आर गुड फॉर यूजिंग देम इन द मिड आईआर स्पेक्ट्रोमेट्री. फोटो कंडक्टिंग होगा तो अगेन दिस इज वेरी फास्ट एंड सेंसिटिव, एंड यू कैन स्टडी द नियर आईआर स्पेक्ट्रम विद दैट. सो दिस इज हाउ बाय वेयरिंग द डिटेक्टर्स, बाय वेयरिंग द सोर्सेज, यू कैन यूटिलाइज द इंस्ट्रूमेंट फॉर डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ सैंपल्स. Then the optical system, it has the gratings and the mirrors which are required to pass on the radiations which are being transmitted to the detector. Then the sample cell, जो आपका sample है जिसको आप study करते हो, आप उसको किसी sample holder में डाल के और फिर आप उसको instrument के अंदर place करते हो. So that has to be very important for us. It has to be transparent to IR. ये ना हो कि जो आप sample holder use कर रहे हो, so that is also IR active. तो वो IR active नहीं होना चाहिए. तो and also it should be inert. अब ये नहीं है कि आपका sample holder आपके sample के साथ ही react कर जाए. We don't want that thing also to happen. And then it should be you can also have a thing so that it can be polished to desired optical quality also. It should be optically transparent, I would say. So these are some of the list of materials which are being used for as a sample holders, and KBR is a commonly used material. Then another instrument is FTIR, and in the FTIR you work in a time domain. जो dispersive spectroscopy आप उस frequency domain में काम करते हो, whereas in the case of FTI you work in a time domain, so that is what has been shown. This is the how the single beam FTI spectrometer it looks like, and this is a case of the double beam FTI spectrometer. So advantages, so that is more important to understand. FTI is better one as compared to dispersive. The reason being is that they have good frequency resolution. Then that means frequency resolution का मतलब क्या है कि आपके पास signal एक ये CH का आ रहा है और एक और CH है in the same system, but इसका environment और इसका environment दोनों का different है. अगर आपका instrument sensitive नहीं होगा तो वो दोनों का signal almost एक ही जगह देगा. लेकिन अगर आपका instrument sensitive होगा then और इसकी resolution अच्छी होगी, then you will find a different signal for these two things. So that is how it is helpful to us. The results they are reproducible, highly sensitivity है इसकी. Then signal to noise ratio is also high. Many times when you are having a low sample concentration, then lot of noise it also comes in the spectrum, and you are not able to understand कि वो जो अब spectrum आया उसमें हमारे sample के signals कहाँ पर हैं. So signal to noise ratio काफी high होती है, so even at the lower concentrations you can work. Faster operation है, computer based है, and it can be easily user friendly. So overall I would say it is a user friendly system. So इसकी uses कहाँ कहाँ पर है? एक तो आप उसको molecular structure determine करने के लिए use कर सकते हो, qualitative analysis में use करते हो, then quantitative analysis में like some filters, hydrocarbon filters in air or in water. So and in the biological samples में, जैसे मैंने आपको बताया था कि protein degradation है, so native protein और degraded protein का structure differ कर जाएगा, so that you can identify. Now coming to the examples which we have where we have used the IR spectroscopy and we have found it to be very helpful in our case. Can anybody tell me that what do you know about penicillin? Penicillin, have you heard of this term previously? Yes, audience?
Yes, ma'am.
Antibiotics.
It's an antibiotic. So it was the first antibiotic which was being came to know. And this is a structure of the penicillin, and what we have done in this case is that we have to convert this penicillin into a probe. It's an antibiotic, so it is a antimicrobial. Okay, it can or in a writer term I would say antibacterial, so it will kill the bacteria. Now what we have tried to do in this particular case is that we have tried to convert this molecule, this penicillin molecule, into the nanomaterial by heating it at higher temperatures in a closed environment. And so this is how the nanomaterial which we have prepared. This is a penicillin carbon dots, and these penicillin carbon dots we have utilized for analysis. We have prepared the two things. एक तो हमने पेंसिलिन इटसेल्फ उसको हमने कार्बन डॉट्स में कन्वर्ट कर दिया, दूसरा हमने कार्बन डॉट्स बनाए एंड अमीन फंक्शनलाइज्ड कार्बन डॉट्स वी हैव प्रिपेयर्ड एंड देन ऑन द सरफेस वी हैव अटैच्ड द पेंसिलिन. ठीक है, सो टू थिंग्स वी हैव डन. अगर हम सीधा पेंसिलिन के कार्बन डॉट्स बनाते हैं देन एट दैट टाइम यू आर हैविंग द कार्बन डॉट्स ऑन विच ऑन द सर्फेस ऑफ विच यू आर हैविंग कार्बोक्सिलिक एसिड, अमीन है, सो इस तरह के फंक्शनल ग्रुप्स हैं. दूसरा है कि आप सिट्रिक एसिड this is citric acid. Citric acid से आप carbon dots बना रहे हो in the presence of amine. You are getting these kind of carbon dots. Now you are attacking intact penicillin on its surface. इसमें आपने penicillin के structure को change कर दिया है. इसमें आपने penicillin का structure as such attach किया है. So now we have tried to identify the structure of these materials with the help of IR spectroscopy. So this is the first IR, which is shown in black. This is of the penicillin G. So this is what it did look like. And this is a region where this, क्योंकि penicillin में देखो amide linkages हैं, amide है, carboxylic acid है. So that is where it will appear, you know, over here. सो दो तरह के कार्बोनिज हैं, एक अमाइड है, एक कार्बोक्सिलिक एसिड का पार्ट है. सो दे आर यू आर सीइंग सच काइंड ऑफ सिग्नल्स एंड देन यू आल्सो सी एनएच सिग्नल ओवर हियर. ठीक है, नाउ व्हेन इन दिस केस यू हैव कन्वर्टेड इन इनटू कार्बन डॉट्स. सो इस आपने इसके एक आपने ये कार्बन डॉट्स बनाए हैं. सो दिस कार्बन डॉट्स they are having an amine functionality on the surface, so its IR spectrum is different. And this is red colored is the IR spectrum of these carbon dots. Now you are having the carbon dots on the surface of which penicillin is attached, that means these ones. So its IR spectrum is coming like this. Agar aap dekho to iska aur iska क्या डिफरेंस आया कि आपने इस अमीन के ऊपर ये पेंसिलिन अटैच की है. सो देन दैट मींस द एनएच फंक्शनैलिटी नाउ द आईआर ऑफ इट शुड चेंज विद रिस्पेक्ट टू दिस ग्रुप एंड दिस इज व्हाट वी सी आल्सो. एंड ओवर हियर देन द लास्ट वन इज द पेंसिलिन कार्बन डॉट्स विच आर शोन. सो अगर आप पेंसिलिन का और पेंसिलिन कार्बन डॉट्स का भी देखो, you see that there is a change in the IR spectrum. Some of the intensities they have got variable, and so this is what you get over here. So we have used the IR spectroscopy to identify these and this particular thing. Now we have utilized this system, so you will see the benefit of now UV spectroscopy over here. We have taken their UV profile, and so each and every system they appear differently. And then we have studied their fluorescence profile also. What we have seen ki agar aap carbon dots ko alag alag wavelength uske upar incident karoge, alag alag monochromatic right uske upar incident karoge, uski jo emission hogi wo variable hogi. So this is what we have seen over here. And this is with time, this is how it is changing. And this is the electron spectroscopy, electron microscopic images of the nano materials which we have prepared. So this is how you can see 30 nanometer ka ye scale hai, aur kitne chote chote particles yahan par bane hue hain. Theek hai, so this is what you can see, that how small the structures they have been created. And then we have tried to study their effect, whether they can kill the different microbes, E. coli, Staphylococcus aureus, the multi-drug resistant strains of E. coli, and the MRSA strains. So this is what we have studied with them. And what we have seen, so ye jo hai, this is the image of the E. coli bacterium. And what we have seen is that when this E. coli, they are treated with the penicillin carbon dots. So you can see, though ye bacteria the, their cell wall is so intact. Now after the treatment, the cell wall has got broken, and so their bacteria, they have been killed because of the rupturing of their cell wall. And these are the fluorescence images which tell that the carbon dots, they have moved inside the cells. Ye jo cell hai, ek bacterial cell hai, uska humne treatment kiya पेंसिलिन कार्बन डॉट्स के साथ. नाउ वी नो दैट द पेंसिलिन कार्बन डॉट्स दे कैन एमिट द लाइट इन द डिफरेंट वेवलेंथ. वो ब्लू भी करेगा, वो ग्रीन भी करेगा, वो रेड भी करेगा, डिपेंडिंग अपॉन आपने उसको कितनी एनर्जी प्रोवाइड की. एंड दिस ग्राफ इज द प्रूफ दैट द पेंसिलिन कार्बन डॉट्स दे हैव गॉट इनसाइड द बैक्टीरिया सेल्स. ये बैक्टीरिया के सेल्स के अंदर चले गए, एंड आफ्टर दैट दे हैव killed these bacteria by breaking their cell wall. So this is what we have studied, and for preparing these penicillin carbon dots, we have used the IR spectroscopy technique. Here is another thing which we have done. We have prepared the quantum dots, again a different nanomaterials, which are made up of zinc oxide, and we have attached the organic molecule on its surface. So that it can happen in two ways, depending upon whether it is only attaching from one side or it is attaching from both the sides symmetrically. Ye non-symmetrically bhi attach probe different hai. Ye symmetrically bhi attach ho sakte hain yahan par jaise hai aur non-symmetrically jaise yahan par hai. So what we have seen again with the help of, I would not focus on the NMR or XRD or the SEM images. But I will focus now over here on the IR spectroscopy क्योंकि ये हम लोग बात कर रहे हैं. So हम लोगों ने जब ये organic molecule को quantum dots के ऊपर attach किया, ये asymmetrically इसके ऊपर attach हो गए. So a part of it has got attached onto the surface, whereas the other part is hanging outside. And so what we have seen, ये जो IR spectrum है, ये मैंने focus किया है with respect to this double bond. So what will happen over here is that we know that C double bond and kis region mein aata hai? Can anybody tell me? Yaad hai kisi ko? Okay, now let me go back. C double bond and it falls in this region. Theek hai? Between 1500 to 2000, right? So by using this information, so this is how the C double bond N of this molecule, kyunki ye symmetrical molecule hai, iske jo hai jo dono C double bond N hai, dono same type ke hai, so they will appear at one, they will give one signal. But now when they have got bound with the carbon dots, quantum dots, sorry, so now C double bond N and this C double bond N, they are different. क्योंकि इसमें जो C double bond N है वो carbon dot quantum dot के साथ interact कर रहा है. So इसका force constant different है, इसका force constant different है. So now they have got split into two signals. So this is what we have found with the help of IR spectrum. And then we had done some studies to find out to use it as a sensor. And then we have found that it is a very good sensor for magnesium. And we have also tried to study this thing in the microbe cells. With the microbe cells, what we have seen, this is the microbe cells. Image nazar nahi aayegi aapko kyunki aapka jo material hai ye fluorescent nahi hai isme. To microbe cells mein normal medium mein agar aap culture karoge, aap uska microscope ke niche dekhoge, aapko nazar nahi aa rahe hai. But when you are having this microbe cells mein aapne magnesium metal magnesium ions dale hain, then also things are not visible. So but when you are having the this microbe cells plus magnesium and your probe, that means probe is this one. So ye probe jo hai ye magnesium ke sath interact karti hai. So ye probe jab humne us system mein dali aur magnesium dala microbes mein, we see that it has got been illuminated and we can see the presence of the microbe cells. And so this is how the thing has been helpful. So what we have used IR spectroscopy, it as a characterization tool for the preparation of various kind of receptors, or I would say preferably as sensors, and to identify the structure of these sensors. And then these sensors we have used either for the detection of the bacteria or the detection of the analytes like magnesium ions. Okay, and then we have many more examples where we have done a lot of work with the help of these techniques in our laboratory. And obviously now the time is now I would say it's almost more than 20 minutes now I have taken, though I would say the time was less if you are talking about two techniques at the same time, right? And so with this I would finish my presentation, and I thank you all. This I have shown the picture of a way to road to the student center, and the library of this university, the main library of this university. So whenever you come across to Punjab University, and so this is the kind of place you will see around, and I would be happy that if you will come over here. And with this, I finish my presentation. And if you have any queries related to this, then you can ask me. Though I know now you people might be feeling hungry also. So if any queries, you can ask me.
Thank you, ma'am. So ma'am has carried out a very thorough presentation of the two techniques, though I agree with her that for these two versatile techniques, the time was indeed less. But I hope you have been able to grasp the concepts, and she has also elaborated with the help of examples from her own research work, which is very important to understand the applications of these two techniques. So I hope students, you have benefited a lot. Now I open the session for discussions and for queries. So if you have any questions, you are most welcome. I know definitely you must be having, don't be hesitant to ask. Every question is a good question. So don't think whether I should ask or not. So you're welcome. Hanji, anyone? Yes, Gurleen, want to ask something? Any question? You were sending some questions in the chat box. I hope you can ask them on your own now.
Hello.
Hanji Gurli, can hear you.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, I have some doubt, ma'am. हमने ना online course join किया, उसमें दो question थे IR के, वो मेरा doubt है. अगर मतलब ma'am को मैं भेज दूँगी आपको, ma'am proceed कर देंगे आगे. उसमें ma'am दो question हैं, वो solve नहीं हो रहे हैं IR के.
Yeah, you sure you can contact me in that case. There's no such problem. But if it is okay with you, you can ask me here also. And if you are comfortable in emailing me, then you can email me also.
Yes,
ma'am. So, ma'am, MSc students are actually carrying out a MOOC course related to spectroscopy on Swayam platform, as industrial training was not possible in this session. So we have asked them to enroll for MOOC courses. So the MSc students have joined the spectroscopy course. So they were indeed excited for this workshop. And students, I would say, I would like to quote Sir C.V. Raman. He said, ask the right questions and nature will open the doors to its secrets. So Sir C.V. Raman, India's only Nobel laureate in science, he asked just one question, that why is the sky blue? And in the quest to find the answer to this question, you know, he discovered the Raman effect, and ultimately which led to the development of the techniques, which is Raman spectroscopy, and all of you read it in your... So the asking of questions is very crucial, particularly for science students, though for all of us, but for science students. So I hope that this lecture will lead to opening of many doors, and many questions will definitely arise in your minds, and time will come. And spectroscopy is a tool to open such doors, and it allows the nature to reveal its secrets through spectroscopy. So with this, we come to the end of today's session on UV visible and IR spectroscopy. So ma'am has provided a thorough presentation, and she has also put many examples in order to enable you to understand the concepts better. She has invited you. You can mail her, you can also contact her later in case you wish to. So ma'am, we are very, very thankful to you for this session. Now I invite Professor Simrat to propose a vote of thanks for today's session. Professor Simrit.
Thank you, ma'am. A distinguished speaker of the day, Professor Navneet Kaur, Professor Pradeep Kaur, coordinator of the workshop, Dr. Kamalpreet Kaur, co-coordinator, my worthy colleagues and dear participants. A very good afternoon to all of you. It's a matter of great honor for me to propose the vote of thanks. I would like to express a hearty thanks to Professor Navneet Kaur for gracing the first day of this 5-day workshop on spectroscopic techniques and their biological applications with her presence. Thank you, ma'am, for your brilliant and very interesting talk. You explained things beautifully. Your way of illustrating things was commendable. Thank you for making excellent presentation and making this workshop meaningful for our students. I strongly believe that all students have learned a lot about the concepts of UV visible and IR spectroscopy and would no longer find these topics difficult. I would like to express a profound gratitude to our director principal for his moral support and guidance for this workshop. Finally, a big thanks to the wonderful students for patient listening. I'm sure you have many takeaways from today's session. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Thank you once again.
Thank you all, and I would say I would applaud your initiative. And
this is an announcement for you that, based on today's session and the feedback form is to be put in the chat box now, and you are to attempt that. So Navneet ma'am, thank you so much. It was
wonderful
having you amongst us today. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.